Okay. Hi, everybody. Now I'm on. Okay. Let's get started. They just love the fellowship, right? We all do. It's great to have everybody here this morning. Welcome to those watching on Facebook. We've got a lot coming up in the next couple of months. I want to try to get through these announcements here. I don't have my announcements on back there. Oh. All right. Thank you. Well, anyway, welcome, and we are glad to have you here this morning, and the weather's beautiful, and we're just blessed, aren't we? We don't even know it sometimes. Just a couple of date announcements, and then, of course, let's not forget our regular announcements as well. First of all, October 12th is a Saturday. We're going to have our leadership meeting, and we usually do it Sunday after church. We're going to do it a Saturday night at 5 o'clock. And we'll serve you dinner. Okay, so that'll be on October 12th. October 27th is a Sunday. After church, we will have a harvest potluck, and you can bring soups, salads. Well, you can bring whatever you want to, but we usually do, I usually call it our Super Sunday, and we have lots of soups and chilies and, you know, harvest eat, fall type foods, but that's the theme anyway, but you bring what you want, and I know Carl always likes cheesecake, so I got a plug for that. And then November 23rd, it's also a Saturday night, 5:30, we will have a potluck dinner, and then a short service after that, probably, so it will be done by 7:30, so come and join us. That's a Saturday night for a Thanksgiving dinner, and a quick Thanksgiving devotion, and then December 1st, and that is a Sunday. You know, I had to have Kira put Saturday and Sunday up there because I was getting really confused. But anyway, December 1st, it's a Sunday after church. We're going to have we're going to have you guys help, at least some of you that can climb up anyway. Way up here on the top, we have all of our Christmas stuff. And so we're going to have them climb up there and hand things down and pull all of our Christmas stuff down. And for those of you that haven't seen our decorations on Christmas, it's absolutely beautiful. We usually have a tree back over here that goes all the way up. And so we're going to be pulling out all the Christmas decorations on the 1st. And then Saturday the 7th, 6 days later, we're going to, at around lunchtime, 11 o'clock, we'll have lunch served too, but we'll have everybody that wants to come and decorate the church for the holidays. And last year we had quite a few people, and boy, that was such a blessing, especially to have the men help us put up that humongous tree. So, and making sure all the lights work and that kind of thing. That's Isaac's favorite part. He's like, no. He gets stuck doing it almost every year, don't you, Isaac? He does a great job. But anyway, we have that happening. And then, of course, on December 24th is our Christmas Eve service. It's a Tuesday night. It'll probably, I'm guessing, did I say 6 o'clock last night? Okay. We usually have it about 6 o'clock. It's a candlelight service, and it's 1 hour. We don't want to take all your Christmas Eve, so we just have a quick Christmas Eve service on the 24th. Couple of other announcements real quick too. On the back table, we have some more little cards, and this has a 2024 calendar, but on the other side, it talks about a salvation message. So if you want to take some cards with you that have a calendar on the back, maybe to stick in your wallet or something, or stick a few, you can hand these out. They're back there. Just feel free to take them. And then the other thing is on October 25th from 5 to 8, over at First Church of the Nazarene on Stanford, they're having a dinner, a silent auction, and a kids' talent show. And this is to raise money for the Good News Clubs and the kids in the area. And we want to reach more kids in the Southern Colorado area through Good News Clubs. So this helps to raise the money for that. And if you would like to purchase a ticket for the dinner and the silent auction and the talent show, it's $15 a person, and it goes to a really good cause. I think Matt is selling some tickets today. And then, yes, he has the tickets back there. Thank you, Matt. And then you'll get one of these little flyers, and you will also get the tickets to take with you. And then remember that it's October 25th from 5 to 8. And we will announce this again next week, okay? So just... Oh, they have a bounce house for kids. They have some activities and bounce houses for kids. So that'll be fun for them to join in on that. Okay? And then if you know some kids that have a talent, you know, maybe some of the boys, you know, they dance pretty good. You know, those break dancing boys or whatever. I don't know. Anyway, maybe some of the boys or someone who has kids that have a talent that would like to be in the talent show, I can put you in touch with Renee over there at the First Church to get you ready for that. So thank you, First Church, for putting this on. And we look forward to that. A couple of our regular announcements. Remember also, this is the time of year, too, that the YWCA and the Rescue Mission can use some coats and boots and shoes and things like that for either the homeless or for those in need. So if you are needing to clean out your closets and maybe you buy a new coat or something, then your old one is gently used. You want to bring it down. We have boxes in the back by Pastor Jim's desk that we can put that in, and we'll be happy to take that down there for you. Tithes and offerings, if you'd like, if you're in the sanctuary and you're giving to the Lord today, Carl will pass a plate, or we have a box in the back underneath the clock. You can drop your tithe or offering in there. And if you're watching on Facebook, or if you like to give online, you can go to www.pwlivingwaterfellowship.com. That's our website. Again, www.pw for Pueblo West, livingwaterfellowship.com, and you can give online as well. And also on our website, there's lots of, we have the calendar up of events coming up, and then we also have just a lot of different things about our church and stuff like that. So you're welcome to check out our website. And did I get all the announcements? I think I did. Wow. Let's talk about some prayer requests real quick. Pat, how is Pat doing? Okay, so those of you watching on Facebook, Pat is healing. She's home from the hospital. We want to remember her in prayer. Okay, yes, she did call and say thank you for the prayers. So let's continue to keep her in prayer. The last time I spoke with Nona, she was going to a rehab center in Canyon City. She has Parkinson's, and so we want to remember to keep her in prayer. And I do have a cell phone number for her, and she supposedly has her cell phone on her, but a lot of times she doesn't answer her phone. So if you want to keep trying, you can try to get a hold of her and see how Nona's doing. We want to continue to keep our church in prayer for volunteers, for various service roles in the church. Children's church, drummer, you know, sound, video, there's all kinds of opportunities here in the church if you feel the Lord leading you to get involved. And then we also want to remember to keep Charlie and Lynn in prayer. And there's been some transition there, and we want to make sure to definitely keep both of them in prayer. Charlie, we do every day. And then I know, you know, I asked about this last night, and vulnerability and connection within our church. I said, Kira, what's that all about? Let me tell you, there are people, even in our own church family, but anywhere really, that maybe they're Christian, but they feel vulnerable or feel like they cannot be vulnerable in front of others in the church. And they feel kind of disconnected and maybe closed off and feeling like no one cares type of feeling. And, you know, a couple of people in the church have mentioned that and just feeling that disconnect. And, you know, I think a lot of times that's the enemy. He wants us to feel disconnected, and he wants us to feel like no one really cares about our problems or what we're going through. And I want you to know, if you're here today and you feel that way, that that's not true. We love each and every one of you, and we're praying for each and every one of you. Jim and I spend hours, sometimes in the middle of the night, praying for our church family. And we want you to know that you are family to us. And if there's anything that you need, there is always someone here in the church that can help you and reach out to you and be a part of. Maybe it's healing. Maybe it's just someone to talk to. Maybe it's, financial. Whatever it is, we're a family. And we would love to have you be a part of that. We don't want you to ever feel like you're not connected with Living Water Fellowship. So thank you for putting that up there, because it is a reminder that, especially today and all the chaos going on in the world, that people feel very lonely. And to be able to reach out to them is important. So anyway, I wanted to mention that. And then just real quick, a thank you to all who donated time, pizzas, drinks, money, all of that donated for the McElfrish's move, and also for Lynn's move. We did two, I said we, but actually Jim and the boys did a lot of that this week. And his boys at the home that he works at were just so good this week at helping to get things loaded up and ready for the McElfrishes to move. And it was a blessing, and they enjoyed it, and they enjoyed working, and we just thank you for that. We were able to bless them with some money, and try to convince them not to go out and buy $200 shoes, but not that we had that much money, but that's what they want to do. They want to go buy expensive shoes. But hey, they earned it, so God bless them for it. And we do have Rosemary's move coming up soon, and you're going to let us know. Okay, and we still have some funds for that, so what a blessing for those of you that have still been giving funds to help with that. And I have some boxes, a couple, and I know that you can probably use some more boxes too, maybe. So anyway, just wanted to thank everybody for their help on that. The McElfrishes did make it safely there, and they had someone, I think from a high school hockey team or something, to help unload and get their house set up. So they're busy doing that. So we will keep them in prayer as they transition. And I think that's everything, right? All right, let's praise the Lord.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Okay. I say that for a couple of reasons. See if you're awake, and then make sure my microphone is working.
Yeah.
Pretty much. I wanted to kind of echo real quickly what Sue was saying about vulnerability and connectivity. Mm-hmm. And as a pastor, I'm sort of busy, but I am never, ever too busy to take a phone call, a text. And those of you that know me know that's true. I will get back with you. Stop. No, I'm just kidding. I will get back to you. I will answer your call if I can. If I can, I'll get back to you, because I want you to know we are a family. And if you are hurting or need prayer or something, please call me. Please text me. Let me know. A lot of you do that. If you have questions about things, I love it. If I don't have an answer, which is the case sometimes, I can find it. I will look it up. I'll research it. I'll go to the book of books and find that answer for you. So I guess what I'm saying is I'm here for you. Okay?
Yep.
Right.
Okay. If you'd like to stand with us, we're going to worship the Lord.
Start with this good old song right here.
Yep.
One, two, three, four.
those older songs. Thank you, Jesus, for this beautiful day. Thank you, Lord, for the sunshine and the blessings that you give us, those that we can clearly see and even those that we don't know about, Lord, or don't think about. Thank you, Lord, for all that you've done for us. Thank you, Lord, for bringing us here this morning and for those watching, Lord. Lord, we just have so much to be grateful for, and we want to give you all that we are with lifted hands. Thank you, Jesus. Amen.
One, two, three, one, two,
three. I'm going to have you exercise a little bit this morning. When we get to the point with lifted hands, I want you to lift your hands to the Lord if you're comfortable with that, okay?
Let him hear you sing this song.
Thank you, Jesus. Because we are so thankful for him. Thank you, Father. And count us off.
One, two, three, four.
There's a peace I've come to know. Though my heart and flesh may fail, there's an anchor for my soul. I can say it is well. Jesus has overcome.
Yes, he has.
good.
Good morning, church. So, starting a new series today in Romans. Okay, thumbs up from Brother Carl, one of his favorites. I'm going to do part of this, Romans 1. I'm going to do verses 1 through 17. And I've entitled this, The Power of the Gospel. So if you can stand, let me read what's going on here, and then we'll get into the word, okay? It says, Paul, a servant of Jesus Christ, called to be an apostle, separated unto the gospel of God, which he had promised afore before his prophets in the holy scriptures, concerning his son Jesus Christ, our Lord, which was made of the seed of David according to the flesh, and declared to be the Son of God with power according to the Spirit of holiness by the resurrection from the dead, by whom we have received grace and apostleship for obedience to the faith among all nations for his name, among whom are ye also the called of Jesus Christ. To all that be in Rome, beloved of God, called to be saints, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. First, I thank my God through Jesus Christ for all of you that your faith is spoken of throughout the whole world. For God is my witness, whom I serve with my spirit in the gospel of his Son, that without ceasing I make mention of you always in my prayers, making request if by any means now at length I might have a prosperous journey by the will of God to come unto you. For I long to see you that I may impart unto you some spiritual gift, to the end ye may be established. That is, that I may be comforted together with you by the mutual faith, both of you and me. Now I would not have you ignorant, brethren, that oftentimes I propose to come unto you, but was let hitherto, it says, that I might have some fruit among you also, even as among other Gentiles. I am a debtor, both to the Greeks and to the barbarians, both to the wise and to the unwise. So as much as in me is, I am ready to preach, I love this, the gospel to you that are at Rome. Check this out. For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. Huh? For it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. Last verse here. For therein, get this, guys, for therein is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by faith. You may be seated. The main theme, for I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. Why wouldn't it be that, huh? For it is the power of God to salvation for everyone who believes, first the Jew first, and also for the Greek. Lifetime application. For in the gospel, righteousness of God is revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by faith. So as I prayed and put this sermon together, I was trying to figure out, Lord, how should I do this? How should I put this together? And so it occurred to me, or he put it in my mind, that I would want to introduce Paul first, okay? And the letter he wrote to the Romans and discuss what it meant by the gospel. Made sense. To do this, I'm going to ask three basic questions, okay? Number one, who was the Apostle Paul? Talk about him. Number two, why did he write the letter to the Romans? And the big kahuna, number three, who cares? I mean, why should we care about a personal letter written by someone over 2,000 years ago? To answer this question, I'm going to start with the third question first. So if you have your phones or Bibles, you can open your Bibles to Romans 1, verses 16 and 17. These two verses are the whole crux, the whole thesis for this letter that Paul wrote to the Romans. And it says this, and we've already hit it once, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel." Say that with me. "For I am not ashamed of the gospel. It is the power of God for salvation to everyone who has faith, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. For in it the righteousness of God is revealed through faith, for faith as it is written, the one who is righteous will live by faith." These are two dynamic verses, okay? They are packed with the power of the gospel, and their message, their main focus is on this passage. The gospel is the good news. It's the good news. It's the power of God for salvation. Salvation is the act of being saved, right? Or protected from harm and evil or a dire situation. But then the questions of who cares still looms, and saved from what? I think, listen to me carefully here, when a person feels desperate, like they're going to lose something, you ever lost something and you're looking around for it, there's also this great desperation. What did I do with it? I always lose my keys. And Dom's always finding my phone, too, anyway. But there's this desperation. Where did I put it? Where did I lay it? It's like we're going to lose something valuable, or it could be even something like they're going to die. Then that person starts to do something. They start to look for salvation. Some people may not even know that, but that's what they're looking. I need to be saved. I need help here. But if a person is really comfortable, then salvation is not really a big deal. I have a suspicion that one of the reasons for decline in our churches and rejection of God in the United States today is because Christians feel way too secure and comfortable in their lives. And they say, "I don't need God because I have everything that I want. Besides, I can be my own God. I can worship me." And that's what's happening. That's what you're seeing today. Now, let's look at this first question. Who was Paul? I like what Paul says who he is. Paul, if you ask him, if you ever met him, can you imagine this? You ask him who he was, he'd tell you. He wouldn't have a problem telling you who he was. But listen what he says here in verse 1. He says, "Paul, a bondservant," that's a person bound in service, sometimes without wages, "of Jesus Christ." A bondservant of Jesus Christ. And he says, "I was called to be an apostle." Apostle is a teacher. Separated or set apart to the gospel of God. Think about that a minute. Are we called to be a teacher? Are we called to be separated from God, separated to God, or set apart for God? Now, when we first meet Paul, he was called who? We meet him in the chapter of Acts, chapter 8. He was standing by watching Stephen being stoned to death. I don't know if I could do that. He did. Stephen was the first person to die for proclaiming that Jesus was the Messiah that the Jews had been waiting for. Now listen, Saul was well educated. He was a young man. He had the best of three worlds, okay? He was Jewish by birth, but was born in a Roman colony in Asia Minor, and he received a Roman citizenship. And I would tell you that would be unheard of. That would have been unheard of and very rare for a Jew. He was educated in Greek philosophy and in the Jewish religion. He moved to Jerusalem and studied with famous rabbis, including the famous teacher Gamaliel. He was a leading authority of the Sanhedrin. And you can find this in Acts 22:3. Paul was destined to become a powerful leader of his people. Okay? He didn't know how he was going to make that happen, but God did. He was very much against the followers of Jesus. One day he got permission from Jewish leaders, probably from Gamaliel, I don't know, to go to a northern town called Anybody know? Damascus, to round up Christians that, and then have them arrested and possibly executed. On his way to Damascus, he encounters God. You know, when we encounter God, something's going to change. Something is going to change. And if we hear God and listen to him, he will change us. So he drops off the scene. He has this dramatic conversion. He drops off the scene for 13 years. Where's Paul? Okay. God is preparing him. When he comes back, he is leading the missionary. He is a leading missionary to the Gentile people, anybody who was not a Jew. Paul takes his first missionary journey to the region of the Gentiles, okay? He leaves from the city of Antioch. He moves across the island of Cyprus. Then he goes to the region of Galatia. Now, let's remember what happened to Paul and Barnabas. That was his traveling buddy. They were in the city of Lystra. Paul heals a crippled man, okay? The people think he is, him and Barnabas are Zeus and Hermes. Oh, wow. From Greek mythology, oh, they must come back, Zeus and Hermes. And Paul's having a fit. No, 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 no. Then a group of Jews from Pisidian, Antioch, and Iconium come down. These guys really, really hated Paul. Okay, they come into town. They convince the people to stone Paul. Paul spent his entire ministry being persecuted. He really did. He was beaten 3 times with wooden rods. Thick wooden rods, about that long. He was stoned once, and he was shipwrecked. On this occasion, listen to me, his bones were so badly crushed that people actually thought he was dead. But he survived. It had to be divine. It had to be supernaturally. This guy gets up. Can you hear this? Can you hear the bones cracking and breaking and trying to pop back into place? He gets up. I probably would have ran away. Ooh, thought it was a ghost or something. Paul gets up. And I cannot even imagine what his body must have looked like. Even so, he heals. He moves on. And he goes on 2 more journeys. During one of these journeys, he spends 18 months in the city of Corinth, hanging out with 2 people, 2 married people, a couple, Aquila and Priscilla. They are Jewish people who moved to Corinth because of the Roman Empire forced all the Jews out of Rome. Paul and Aquila are making tents, and they're sitting around talking about Rome. Paul has never been to this church, but he feels like he needs to go there. He needs to see these people because he feels like he knows them. Now, this leads me and us to our second question. Why did he write the letter? What was this all about? Why did Paul write this? Paul's in Corinth. He's been collecting money from the Gentile churches in order to help the church in Jerusalem. It was suffering from famine and hunger. Paul wanted to go all the way to Spain, but he knew he'd have to go through Rome, and going this way, he figured he'd be literally at the end of the earth there. So he writes this letter to the church of Rome. He introduces himself and he explains to the people in the church who he's all about and how he defines the gospel. So here is a basic overview of what Paul said. I'm going to give this to you in the first 4 chapters of Rome. Are you ready for it? Of Romans, are you ready for it? Get ready. The first chapter includes or establishes that the Gentiles have turned away from the Creator to worship idols, created things. This is idolatry. So the Jews are going, yay, yay, this is really cool. Amen. Right on, Paul. And then Paul turns on them. In the second chapter, Paul says, hold on a minute. Wait a minute. My Jewish brothers and sisters, you have turned away from God and put your trust in self-righteousness, thinking that the law of Moses makes you better than everyone else. You know, sometimes I don't understand religion. I never really found in the Bible Jesus talking about religion. What I saw in the Bible is Jesus saying, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And you know what our problem is? We get too focused on our own religiosity that we don't see God. And this is what the Jews were doing. They were worried about following the law to the T and probably breaking it most of the time themselves anyway, instead of wanting to know what God was talking about. This is what's happening today. This is what is exactly happening. Let's change the Bible. Let's step away from the truth. Let's see if we can find something else that makes us feel better. Now, the fourth chapter, but the third chapter can be summed up in Romans 3:23. Anybody know what that is? For all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. That's what Paul tells them. You're sinners too. We're all sinners. And he says, we're all equal and we need salvation. Chapter 4 ties it all back to the beginning with God's simple promise to Abraham. It comes down to God's faithfulness, God's promise, and Abraham's faith in God's faithfulness. Focusing in on chapter 1, verses 2 to 4, it says that God was promised, the gospel was promised by God through his prophets. Prophets were messengers. They were promised through the Holy Scriptures. They told people that Jesus was coming. And three, they talked about God's Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, who was born through the line of David according to the flesh, because Jesus was both man and God. People will argue with on that. Jesus was God, but he was also man. He was born through David. Okay? And four, he was declared to be the Son of God with power according to the Holy Spirit, or the Spirit of holiness, by the resurrection from the dead. Jesus was God. People will tell you today, well, I don't believe that. I don't understand that. That doesn't make any sense. It may not make any sense, but let me tell you, Jesus is God. And he loves you, and he wants you to confess your sins, and he wants to change your life and transform you. I'm going to tell you something, church. None of us in here can change anyone. We can't do it. But you know what we can do? We can tell them of someone who can. You can share your story with them, and then you listen to their story, but you tell them about the power of the gospel and how it can change people. This is what Paul was doing. Here in verse 5, Paul gives a more accurate picture of how he sees the gospel. Paul identifies himself as one who cannot be separated from Jesus. Can we do that today? Huh? Is your life like this with Jesus, where you have all the space in between? I don't understand how many Christians can sit in church and not know God, but it happens. I don't know him. And you know what's really sad? They don't want to know him. I'm comfortable the way I am. I'm not, and I've heard older Christians say, well, I've done all I can do. I'm ready. Ready for what? Wrap a blanket around your legs and sit in a rocking chair? What are you ready for? God wants us to stay in the fight, to glorify him and edify others until he calls us home. We don't have any right to sit down and stop and say, I'm done. I've done all I can do. He went all the way for us, guys, all the way to the cross. He came out on the other side. He rose from the dead. He is at the right hand of God right now. But he can live right here if you allow him to. In verse 6, let me say this though first. God is using Paul to bring good news to the faithfulness demonstrated through Jesus and in the power of the Holy Spirit to all nations. We need to be telling everyone about Jesus. He was not there to convert them to a new culture, church, but to transform them within their own culture to know the love of God. Sometimes I have problem with missionaries who go stomping over to a new place. I'm going to show them a new culture. No, you show them Jesus within their culture. That's what you do. And we need to do that in our own churches. Somebody may not understand, and it's our job to tell them about Jesus and let God fix the other part. And let God fix the other part. So in verse 6, Paul's letter is targeted to those that belong to Christ in Rome. He points out what it means to obey Christ's call and to believe in him. It's hard for us. We say that in our current day situation. Well, it's hard for me to do that because things are different now. What is different? What is different from serving God that they did back then that we're doing now? You know what? It's because sometimes of our stuff, sometimes of our busyness, sometimes we just don't want to take the time. I believe God has called each and every one of us to be special to him, to be separated to him, because he wants us to do something great for him. And we take God and put him in a little box. That's what we do. He's right here. God's right here. God is huge. He can do the small things and he can do the large things. And we need to stop trying to control God and let him control us. That's what we need to do. I'm tired of listening to churches on the radio talking about, well, we need, and if you need to be prosperous, just do this. If you need to have money, just to do this. I'm telling you, what we need is Jesus in our lives to change us, to transform us, and we need to talk about the gospel, which is Jesus. Tired of listening to it. I hear it all the time. Preachers are walking away and teachers are walking away from the church because they say, I'm tired of it. What are you tired of? What if Jesus out on the cross had said, you know, this hurts, I'm done, and stepped down and walked away? Where would we be? Not sitting here thinking about it, that's for sure. Be a different story then. He says that all sins can be forgiven. This is the one area that I preach fervently about because a lot of times, guys, Christians say, I've done things that cannot be forgiven. I've crossed the line. I just can't come back. You're right. You can't. But God can bring you back. God can lift you up. God can save you. God can change you right where you stand. He can do it like that. Well, does that mean I'll have everything I want in my life? No. You know, the life of a Christian is hard. It's very hard. There are things you want to say, well, God didn't see that. I can just kind of do that. Oh, I can kind of slip here. We're not going to be perfect. But when we are in Jesus, we become perfect. We become better. We become sinless and more sinless. And we won't want to do those old things that we used to do. Our heart is so full of God that we want to be like him. We want to be like Christ. Amen? In 7, Paul continues to say, all repentant people can be made right by God because of what Jesus did on the cross. What he did on the cross for us. Verse 7, Paul continues to write to everyone in Rome at the time who was both loved by God to be the saints. All those who read this letter are called saints or holy ones. Do you know that you're holy? Do you believe that? You need to. I struggled with that one, I'm not going to lie. How can it be holy? Because I was comparing myself to God. Don't do that. You can't compare yourself to God. But God says we are holy because he is holy. You cannot imagine how much he loves you. I can't. Can't fathom it. But I know it's there because I felt that love. You ever felt that love? Sometime in your prayer, stop and just ask God to put his arms around you. Maybe that's all you can do in your prayer, and hold you and love you. And you'll feel that warmth. You'll feel God, his presence, and the Holy Spirit just holding you. He loves us so much. We can write books on why, probably. We're not very nice. We're not very good. But he doesn't care about that. You know what he cares about? Your relationship with him. Verses 8, 9, and 10, Paul completes his letter of gratitude in verse 7. He is thankful that the Romans, in their faith, proclaimed to all the world. In other words, the Christians in Rome have become famous far and wide for believing in Jesus. This is Paul's mission in life. And I ask you, what is your true mission in life? To work? Get up in the morning and do that slave thing with that work? Well, I get tired of that sometimes. Last week, I was up at 4 o'clock. There ain't nobody up at 4 o'clock in the morning. Except Blaze barking. What is your mission in life, church? Your true mission in life? Huh? Make money? That only goes so far. And I'm not knocking about paying bills and doing all that. We have to do that. But what is your true mission in life? Paul figured it out. It was to glorify God. All the time. Not just on Sunday. I've heard Christians say, well, I guess I'll go to church today. God doesn't want Christians in his church with that kind of attitude. I guess I'll pray. Should be a loud voice to say, I guess I'll hear you maybe. Think about it. We're awful. We complain. We whine. And then we ask God in the end, can you help me? God says, I don't really know you. I don't really know you. Who are you? Well, I'm Jim down here. And I got a problem and I need you. Where were you back then? Why weren't you talking to me back then? Now you need me? But you know the funny thing about God is he'll do it. He'll come running. Just like the prodigal son. He sees him. The father sees him far off. And what the guy kicked his sandals off. And he's running to wrap his arms around his son. That's the father we serve. So we are holy. We are all officially holy. Paul's mission in life was given to him by Christ to see belief in Christ spread to all the nations. Boy, if you're not telling people about Jesus, you're missing a blessing from God. But that's hard, Pastor Jim. Well, I didn't say it was easy. What is your job? Do you know Jesus? I do. Could we share a little bit? It's not that hard. The other thing is living your life like Christ. People really see that first. So if you got that hip thrown up on the bar stool in the bar, running your mouth, they see that too. You're a Christian? Yeah, I'm a Christian. As you take a big swallow of Bud. Huh? And I've said this before. Why should they listen to you or follow you when you're doing what they're doing? They could care less. He's just like me. Why would I be a Christian? We got to be different. We have to act holy. That's not being narcissistic or conceited. It's being Christ-like. I want people to see Jesus in me, not Jim. That's for sure. Jim's not so good. Christ in me is so much better. I want people to see that. Paul has an incredible prayer life. How's your prayer life? I do it when I need him. What? Paul models his prayer life, and we should look at it. He was a praying man. He would have to be. The guy get beat down with wooden rods and stones thrown on him and gets up. Somebody's praying. I don't think he could dodge too many of those stones very long. Ooh, miss me. Ooh, ooh. No, some of them stones is hitting you and they're killing you. God help us. What is your prayer life? Pray without ceasing. What does that mean? Well, do I walk around and pray? Yeah. You can pray anywhere. You can pray on your way to work. You can pray in your home when you get up. You can pray with your friends. You can have silent prayers in your mind for somebody. Pray without ceasing. God hears those prayers. People are afraid to pray. Why? I've heard people say, I can't pray in public. Do you pray privately? Do you talk to God in your prayer room? Just you and God. And you go to battle. And let him lead you and fill you. Or do you forget about it? I suggest to you today, more than ever, that you need to pray. It's not getting any better out there. Huh? Just because you say you're a Christian, listen to me, doesn't protect you from all the lunacy out there. But listen to me. If you're praying, if you're reading the Word, if you're living your life like God, He's with you. He's right here in your hip. I'm almost done. Bear with me, church. Paul said in 11, verses 11 to 14, he said in 11, Paul says he wanted to see the brothers to give them some spiritual gifts so the church could be established. 12, and be encouraged together and mutual. That's what we do in a church. We share our spiritual gifts. We share the knowledge that we have with somebody else to lift them up, to edify them. Don't stand around at living water and say, I don't know what to do. And if you come to me and you say, well, I don't like that, that needs to be done. You know what I'm going to say? You're right. Can you do that for us? Can you do that? I want you to do that. I bet you can do that. People have backed away from me on that. Ooh, that brother's crazy. I don't want to be the one. Because I'm going to ask you. You got a problem with it? Fix it. I will support you. I got $5 in my pocket. I'll support you. Whatever you need. I love what Paul says. He wanted to bear fruit among them. Are we bearing fruit among people in our church? Huh? Are we setting like knots on a pine board? You ever seen a pine board with a big old knot in it? What's it good for? Not much. You try to hammer through it, you can't. It's too hard. Are we pliable and soft for God to do the things of God? Or are we like hard knots? Do we love God first enough to say, you're more important, Lord, than this over here? Because you see, when you do that, God will fix this over here, church. He'll fix it. When you give it up to him first, he'll fix the other stuff in your life. And I know that's true, because he's done it for me. Now let's get to the big question. Why should we care about a 2,000-year-old letter which Paul wrote to the church of Rome, which was divided between the Jews and the Gentiles? Let me tell you why. Here's the answer. I am not ashamed of the gospel. Even when they were stoning him, bring it, Paul's saying, because I am not ashamed of the gospel. Where are you at in your walk? Are you timid about being who you are in Christ? I think most of us are sometimes. I don't want people to really know I'm a Christian. Why not? You don't have to wear a placard or a sign or a shirt that says I'm a Christian. I get a little leery of people that do that. Walk around with a big Bible in the back pocket, and they never read it because there's dust on it. What I am saying, don't be ashamed of who you are in Christ. He says, I'm not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God for salvation, first to the Jews and also to the Gentiles. There's the whole crux of it right there. He's meaning everybody. 15, Paul states, with everything I am, listen to what he says, church, with everything I am, I'm ready to preach the gospel to you who are in Rome. I love this because I feel the same way. I'm just who I am, small church, but with everything I have that God has given me, I'm ready to preach the gospel every Sunday. I will tell you that with my whole heart. So what about us today? Is the power of the gospel in the 21st century right here in Pueblo, West Colorado? I hope it's here at Living Water Church, at least. We need to take it to other people, too. They need to know who we are. That could be answered in many different ways. Listen, all of us are into some kind of bondage, and we need to be saved. Something may have a grip on your mind and heart that is not allowing you to experience the love of God. It's little things. It's not just the big things. It's the little things. Maybe you're focused so much on your job, the people at your job. Don't worry about the people at your job. Worry about how you have God in you around the people at your job. God will take care of them. I'm a witness of that. Social media says we have to be a certain way and do a certain thing. You ever seen those ads? I hate social media. Listen, if you're overweight, take this pill, this magic pill with a gallon of water. No exercise, and you'll be svelte. Whatever. I tried it. They never tell you how long before it's supposed to work. I tried it so long, I begin to get other symptoms. Bloating and carrying on. What's it supposed to do? The media will mess you up. God will fix you up. Stop listening to that crap. Read your Bible. Maybe you have difficulty loving and forgiving someone else. Here's a big one, or you struggle with loving yourself. How many Christians I run, I don't care about I hate myself. I live in a, work with a whole group of boys that have told me, each one of them, I hate myself. They know I'm a pastor. Pastor Jim, I hate myself. Why? Why do you hate yourself? I love you. You're a child of God. I care about you. I know, but I hate myself. Someone did not tell them about Jesus. Someone did not share with them about God's filling love. They missed out. I hear probably 2 or 3 times a week, I'm going to kill myself. 14-year-old kid. I want to kill myself, Pastor Jim. Breaks my heart. Why? Because no one cares. Are we caring? Are we telling people enough about Jesus? If you're dealing with these type of things, you're in bondage and you need to be set free. There's only one way to be set free. Repent. Go to God and ask Him to free you. The real big key is to believe it. So you can go to God and ask Him to free you, but if you don't believe it, you're going to end up and feel the same way you do. And many Christians do that. I know it. I know what they say, but they won't let it go. So it comes back. And Satan will work you and beat you down till you don't believe it. That's what he does. He's a liar. I'm almost done. The truth is we're all facing some kind of circumstance or problem or issue that we need to be set free from. I don't know what it is. What is it for you today? Do you feel lost? Maybe it's debt and financial problems. Are you gripped by an addiction? The good news is that God loves you, and the way of Jesus is a new life, and the power of the Holy Spirit gives us the power to live the life for which we were created. That's key. What were you created for? Yourselves? Just to look pretty or handsome? I don't know about that. Most of us break mirrors. Ooh, I'm kidding. We are beautiful people under God, and He loves us, all of us. But He wants us to follow Him. Let go of what's troubling you. Let go of that junk inside and let Jesus fill you up. Let go and walk with God. Completely. I said completely, not sort of, kinda. I'll walk with God on Sunday. Maybe Saturday. Maybe sometime this week. Walk with God every day. This is important to remember that I'm done, truly. For I am not ashamed of the gospel. Keep this in your mind, people. I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God of salvation. He will save you. For everyone who believes, that's the key, to the Jew first and then to the Gentile. For it is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith. As it is written, listen, the just shall live by faith. Amen. Father God, thank you for this dear group of saints that come faithfully to hear your words, not Jim Young's. Fill them with strength and courage that they go out and proclaim your name. Help us, Lord, to understand that you are in control. That you love us beyond anything we can know. We just need to trust in you. I ask these things in your mighty name. Amen. You want to take my sweat rag? You're a sweetie.
It's going over here.
We had a request for this song last week from our dear friend Mary, and I listened to it and I go, oh my gosh, what a beautiful song. It's just so beautiful, and it speaks of how our Lord is faithful. One, two, 3, 4.
You can stand with us. I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hands. That I wake up till I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God. Jesus, help us this week, Lord, to sing of the goodness of you. Help us to remember every moment, Lord, that you're in control, that you have our backs, that, Lord, you go before us, that you're beside us, that you're within us. Lord, may we be a light to others around us. Lord, help us to speak to those around us with boldness, Lord. We are not ashamed of the gospel. In Jesus' holy name, amen.
Amen.
Yay.
Yes, ma'am. Yes. Senna? Yeah, I know him really well. Good guy. Thank you. Thank you very much, Kathy. Okay, you are dismissed. Please go in peace. Pray for the Broncos today. Max? Oh! I just like them. They're not my idols. I know that, Will. Your mama shared that with me. I could care less, she told me. Yeah. So. Yeah. Gotcha, buddy.